beautiful Zion that dwelleth with the daughter of Babylon. For thus saith Yahweh of hosts, and for the glory hath he sent me unto the nations which spoiled you, for he that toucheth you toucheth the apple of his eye.
Shalom, brothers and sisters. I'm Brother Jonas, and the title of this video is Israelite History is Black History. I thought I would put together a little history about Black history. And what most people don't realize is that Israelite history is Black history. We have been told for so long here in America that our history began in 1619, that it began with slavery. Now, anybody with common sense would ask, what was our history prior to 1619? They tell us nothing concerning the history prior to 1619. We had a very rich history. We ruled Europe, and we lost it. If they told us the truth about history, they would have to reveal a great secret. And that secret is, brothers and sisters, that we are the true people of the Most High, Creator of heaven and earth. We are the Israelites, the chosen people. So with this video, I will simply show you a few things that should spark questions in your mind and give you a simple direction of truth that is the best kept secret on the planet. I mean, it's above all other secrets. Don't let nobody tell you anything different. The truth about us is above all secret things. Everything that happens on this earth, with all of its deceptions, is about deceiving you and deceiving the people of the other nations concerning the true people of the Most High. So long as we remain in ignorance, in sin, and wanting to bring every nation home with us to the kingdom, then they will be able to continue to rule us. We are fortunate, however, that the Most High has a timetable. Despite our ignorance and stupidity and disobedience, the Most High has a timetable, and we keep moving forward despite ourselves. In these last days, you have an opportunity to learn about your history, the true history, the history that many people of other nations already know about. But many of you Israelites are still asleep, or walking dead. Many of you have already seen some of the things in this video. But this is for our continued learning and for those whose eyes are just now being opened. Sometimes when we hear the truth from the horse's mouth, it sounds more real to us. So we got some horses here, and we're going to hear some things from their mouths. As for America, Mystery Babylon the Great, the global ringleader, the eagle head in the mist, the Caesar Augustus of today, the handwriting is on the wall. But what does this mean?
Many, America, the Most High has numbered the days of your reign and brought it to an end. Tekel, you have been weighed in the scales and found wanting, lacking much. Farson, your kingdom is divided according to your own wickedness and will fall and be destroyed. The eagle head in the mist shall be no more.
People have known the truth of who we are. It was told to us during the 1700s. It was told to us during the 1800s. It was even told to us during the 1900s. But for some reason, our minds would not grab hold of it and investigate it. Even when we hear it from someone like Malcolm X, we still wouldn't rise up and embrace the truth and proclaim the truth which belongs to us, which is the Word of God, our history.
We believe in the truth that is in the Bible, but we don't believe in the lies that the white man has put in the Bible. We believe in Allah's prophets and the scriptures they brought to the people. We believe in the resurrection of the dead, not in the physical resurrection, but in mental resurrection. We believe that the so-called Negroes are most in need of mental resurrection. Therefore, they will be resurrected first. We believe in the resurrection of the dead, but not when you're physically dead. When you stop breathing and your heart stop beating and that man stick you in the ground, that's all she wrote. You are not going anywhere. Your soul isn't going anywhere. Your body isn't going anywhere. Nothing is happening after that. When you're dead, you are done. That's it. You can forget it. Then if that's all of it, what about the resurrection? He says that our people are dead. Negroes are dead. Walking zombies. You're the one that the book is talking about who is dead. Dead to the knowledge of yourself. Dead to the knowledge of your own people. Dead to the knowledge of your own God. Dead to the knowledge of the devil. Why, you don't even know who the devil is. You think the devil is someone down inside the ground that's going to burn you after you're dead. Why, the devil is right here on top of this earth. He got blue eyes, blonde hair, white skin, and he's giving you hell every day. And you're still too dead to see it. We believe in the resurrection of the dead. We believe that the 20 million black people in America in the last days will be taught the truth. The trumpet of truth will sound in your ear. That is being sounded today, the trumpet of truth. And this truth strikes your ear and strikes your heart. It'll open your eyes. It'll open your ears. It'll make you stand up. It'll do the same thing for you that truth did for the dry bones in the valley. Because the picture of dry bones in the valley is talking about you. The picture of Lazarus laying dead 4 days is talking about you. You are Lazarus. You are the dry bones. You are the prodigal son. You are the lost sheep. You are the people about whom the Bible is speaking who will stand up in the last day when the trumpet is sounded. Black people are waking up. Black people are standing up. Black people are rising up and they're throwing fight into that knee-shaking white man. We believe we are the people of God's choice. That's what we believe. We believe we're the chosen people. We don't believe Jews are the chosen people. We don't believe Jews are the ones going to the promised land. We don't think Jews are a part of God. No, Jews are nothing but another part of that same race of devils that come out of Europe. They didn't even come out of the Holy Land. They come out of the caves of Europe. A Jew, a Frenchman, an Irishman, all of them the same thing. A race of devils. They got different kinds. Germans, Irish, all of them the same thing. Just like you got a German Shepherd, an Irish Setter, a French Poodle, a Chihuahua, but they all dogs. We furthermore, we believe we are the people of God's choice. As it is written, that God would choose the rejected and despised. And we can find no other person fitting this description in these last days more than the so-called Negroes in America. We believe in the resurrection of the righteous. We believe in the judgment. We believe this first judgment will take place as God revealed right here in America. Right. The judgment will take place in America. The resurrection will take place in America. The judgment will take place in America. The separation will take place in America. And the destruction will take place in America. Doom will take place in America. Doomsday will take place right here. This is the place the Bible is talking about. When the Bible mentions Babylon, it means America. When the Bible mentions Sodom and Gomorrah, that's America. When the Bible mentions Egypt, that's America. This is Rome. This is Babylon. This is that wicked kingdom that God is going to come and set flame to in the last day. And you're living in that day right now. And I'm glad.
How can this not move you? The sad thing is, many people of other nations are realizing the truth, and our own people are not. And these heathen are making confessions and making apologies in videos. These are the kind of heathen that would have a good chance of being servants to the Israelites in the kingdom, and have a good chance of embracing the truth that the Israelites will teach them, and at receiving eternal life as our people after the great white throne judgment.
Hi there. My name is Joseph. I'm from Romania, country from EU. And I'm sorry for my English because it's very bad, but I hope understand me with this testimony because I'm a witness at Negro people awakening. Before Roman Empire conquered this country, Romania, the name of the country was Dacia. I believe my ancestors were Romans or Greeks or maybe Dacians, Indo-European people, part of or related to the Thracians. I don't know this for sure. Whatever. Important is about real Israel. Metaphorically speaking, who is the body or the bride of the Most High, who Father is the creator of life, who creates sun, moon, stars, earth, beasts and men. Now I understand, and I'm very sorry for what Greeks, Romans, Ottomans and all empires and pagan people did to Negro brothers, who suffer a hard bondage and atrocities. This is the Great Holocaust. Real Jews, Israelites or Hebrew Israelites have a black skin complexion and hair like wool. Use so-called Afro-Americans or Africans or blacks or Negro must wake up. You are the real Israel who suffered the slavery and scattered on the earth through slavery. Read Deuteronomy chapter 28. You are from tribe of Judah by blood. In your body is the spirit of Most High. You are the living temple. You are your nation's salvation is in your unity, and the earth's salvation is in your unity. We are pagan people, and modern empires must pay for corruption of flesh, earth, and life. You, Israel, chosen by Most High, are the only hope for entire earth. You are the living temple. You are the real church. Your hope is not in corrupt religion with churches with stone and wood, or Ashkenazi, Khazar Jews, Jewish, and Jesuit popes, or corporation or bankers mafia, who want you live now in mental bondage, because you are. They know you are a living temple of Most High. And these elites spray you with toxins from planes and give you pork meat and genetic modified food and his calendar and fluoride waters and drugs and prostitution and divertisement and vaccines and his system, plastic money, tobacco, spiritual wickedness with red white Jesus, electronics, RFID microchips, etc. Christ was black, must be black and is black. King James Bible with Apocrypha is your testament and it's your book and it's your proof for entire earth. Read it. Wake up, save you and save the earth.
Hi, shalom, shalom from Israel. This is Ola, the daughter of Jethro. And I just heard that you black people that was stolen from Africa to America, that you don't know who you are, but you are the children of Yahweh. We need you to come and pray because you are our saviors. You're the one that was chosen by Yahweh.
One of false Christianity's most iconic Christian ministers or evangelists, Billy Graham, actually spoke the truth to millions of people, and the seed of the truth did not take root and bring forth fruit until the last days that we're in. The truth that Billy Graham spoke didn't even bring about a change in his own people.
All over the country, thousands of young people are talking about Christ. They can't escape him. There's a Broadway play right now entitled Godspell, a musical version of St. Matthew's Gospel. There's a new movie right now called Brother John, in which Sidney Poitier plays Jesus Christ in the form of an Alabama black man. The man that helped Jesus carry that cross was a black man. He was born in that part of the world that touches Africa and Asia and Europe. And don't ever forget another thing. Jesus belongs to Africa. And Jesus was not a white man like me. And Jesus was not a white man like me.
A sister in an interview with this white lady reveals one of the truths behind Christianity. I don't know neither of their names, but this white lady explains the whole purpose of using Christianity on us during slavery. Christianity was used to make us look up to the white people as being the children of God, which is a lie. It was used to make us more submissive in all the wicked things they want to do to us. And it was also used to maintain some level of control of other people.
Over the years to non-white people. And there are two particular areas of activity that appear to be critical to maintaining the system of racism and white supremacy. These are activities that people all over the planet engage in. And the first one is religion. So can you talk specifically about what white persons have done to or taught non-white people in the area of religion in the context of racism?
You want me to be the way I can't ever go home. That's it. Christianity has been misused for hundreds of years to keep your people in subjugation. And I'm speaking now a reality that the history books do not record, but history does. Christianity was used because if I said, okay, you don't believe the way I believe, and Christianity is the best way to believe, so I'm going to take you, and it's going to be for your own good, honey. It's going to be for your own good. I'm going to take you, and I'm going to tear away everything about you and just keep your hands and your feet because they can help me getting off. But I'm going to do this for your own good because I'm going to give you a God. Now, what does that God look like? The reality of it is when he came here, he didn't look like me. So what am I going to do about that? I'm going to make him look like me. So for hundreds of years, we've been telling you, and now you have to keep in mind that we took away any other God that you might have through force, through fear, through pain, through any means necessary. So now I'm going to give you a God, but I'm going to do that in a way that is going to further me. So I'm going to give you a God that looks like me, so that when you bow down to that God, you're bowing down to me. Because the reality is, and see, this is something that bothered me when I left the church out of frustration, because I wasn't hearing these things. Because the Bible tells us what Jesus looked like when he walked here. The Bible tells us what he's going to look like when he comes back.
In these last days, we can't even get our own Sunday pork chop eating ministers to tell our people the truth. So it is refreshing when a white Christian pastor speaks the truth of who we are as a people.
Now let me say something right quick. I think back on the African American people in America. I think how that they were taken against their wills, put in the belly of ships, brought over here, beat, cussed. Many of them died in the guts of those ships, thrown overboard. They were pulled from families over there. You ain't never heard a gut-wrenching song. You hear a black person sing one of those old black Negro spirituals. Nobody knows. I can't sing it like that, see, because I hadn't experienced what they be. When you've experienced hell, it comes out of the voice. I said, when you experience hell, it comes out of the voice. If you're one of those people that you got problem with black people or whatever, you better shut your mouth. Because they're God's people. You better hear what I'm saying to you. You better shut your white mouth. You better shut your white mouth. I'm not kidding you. I know some of you was raised in the deep south and you was raised by prejudiced people and bigoted people. You better get that out of your system. You better get it out of your system. It'll cause you to suffer right along with those masters. It'll cause you to suffer right along with them. These are God's people. And I know that there's wicked in white races and wicked in black races and all that. I'm not justifying none of that stuff. I'm just saying God knows what happened to the black race. He knows how they wound up over here. And God is going to reimburse the black people for all their trouble and all their labor. You watch what I tell you. Watch what I tell you. If you're one of those people that you got problem with black people or whatever, you better shut your mouth. Because they're God's people. You better hear what I'm saying to you. You better shut your white mouth. I'm just saying God knows what happened to the black race. He knows how they wound up over here. And God is going to reimburse the black people for all their trouble and all their labor. You watch what I tell you. Watch what I tell you.
You so-called blacks, Hispanics, and Native Indians are the Israelites of the Bible, according to the curses of Deuteronomy 28. And the simple fact of the matter is that my people have lied to you and the whole world about the Bible and have sought to paint their images over your images and to replace you in the Bible, which is your history, heritage, and culture. So the reason that the Israelites went into slavery is because they chose not to keep the covenant that God made with them and them only.
Some biblical historical facts have been presented to others and still you can't see the fruit of that labor. That's because Edom has gone through great detail to keep you asleep, to keep you in mental and spiritual bondage. But as the scripture says in John 8:32, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Listen carefully to what's said.
So, I found that the Old Testament is actually a book of history, and we're going to look at why that is. So the first thing is, Noah's Ark was found. How many people heard about this? A few of you. Okay, cool. Well, Noah's Ark was found in around about 1960 was when it was discovered, and the Americans actually sent a team over basically just to debunk it. So they came back and said, oh no, that's just a natural formation, and they ignored it. But there's a guy called Ron Wyatt who went back and had a look at it and found that indeed this is a site of a remains of a massive boat, and this is a high altitude picture of the site. And I assume you can see where it is, right there. And it's roughly the proportions that are set forth in the Bible. So there's another picture of it. Ron was trying to get permission from the Turkish government to excavate it, and they were dragging their heels, and they weren't going to give him permission. But then there was an earthquake, and it did all the excavation for him. And literally he found that under the ground there was petrified wood. It was all petrified wood. He came along with a team which had ground penetrating radar and metal detectors, and found that they found the superstructure of a boat and metal rivets. And those lines that you can see in the ground there were actually the lines of the metal rivets they were finding. So they actually traced out the shape of a boat. And also they found these ballast stones, which what they used to do at the time was when they had a big boat, they'd tie huge stones over the boat to keep it stable. And just slightly down the valley, they found a load of these ballast stones. So yeah, Noah's Ark was a historical event. The boat was found exactly where the Bible said it would be, in the foothills of Mount Ararat, 70 miles away from the nearest body of water. And the place it was found was called the Valley of the Eight, referencing the eight people who were on the Ark. And as I said, it's the same dimensions as the boat in Genesis. And as it says at the bottom there, every single culture has a flood story. I believe that on Mount Everest, they found seashells that tell you that Mount Everest was covered at one time in water. Romwaya also found the site of the Red Sea crossing. This was in 1978. And I've got a little film to show, but this is the actual crossing or the path that the Israelites took. And it's much different to the one that's been generally accepted. But he found a particular place called Nueva Beach was actually the actual crossing. So we're going to see a little film of what he found. So there you have it. He literally found the site of the crossing. So there was a lot of other physical evidence. In the Bible, there's a story of the split rock at Horeb, where Moses tapped a rock and it split and water started gushing out. They found the rock. They literally followed the site as followed the path that was laid out in the Bible, and they found these landmarks. There's also some other physical evidence. This here is called the Ipua Papyrus, which is in the Leiden Museum in Holland. And it's an account from an ordinary Egyptian person of the Exodus and the plagues and everything. So that's basically physical evidence that this thing actually happened. There's also this thing called the Famine Stele, which is an accounting of the 7 years of plenty and 7 years of famine. So physical evidence there. He also went on to find the real Mount Sinai, this burnt peak mountain. And he actually found Sodom and Gomorrah, which is very interesting because on the site, which was totally desolate, he found lots of pock marks in the ground and in rocks. And when he broke a rock open, inside was a perfect ball of sulfur, pure sulfur. They can't actually make sulfur that pure, but the sulfur was burning as it came down, and it melted the rocks as it hit, and the melted rock actually closed over it. So you found loads and loads of these perfect balls of sulfur, you know, preserved in the rocks. And there was also the pillar of salt was found as well, but that hasn't really been verified. You know, I can't everything that is said as true, but yeah, the pillar of salt was found, but there's only one source of verification, and so I'm not going to really count that. So foundation point two: the Israelites were black people. Okay, they weren't these. These Jewish people. And so I'm going to go into why that is. So no, the Egyptians weren't white people, I'm afraid. Even though all the films that you see and all the illustrations they show white people, it's kind of obvious that the people living in Northeast Africa were black people. So the biblical Israelites were black. It says that Ham, this is according to the Zondervan Bible Dictionary, Ham was the progenitor of the dark races, not the Negroes. They're separate people. But the Egyptians, Ethiopians, Libyans, Canaanites. So it's telling you there that, again, the Egyptians and what became the Africans were black people. So going through the Bible, I'm not going to go through all of these, but yeah, Joseph in the Bible was so much like an Egyptian that his own brothers didn't recognize him. So obviously he looked like an Egyptian, so you know, the Israelites were black people. Moses was also an Israelite, but he was raised under the nose of Pharaoh. So, you know, he'd kind of stand out if he was a white guy. And he was also mistaken as an Egyptian by the daughters of the priest of Midian. And also Moses' sister, Miriam, was turned white as a punishment. So Charlton Heston played Moses in the Ten Commandments film. There was a bit they left out of that film, was when the Most High, as a test or a demonstration of his power, he told Moses to put his hand into his tunic and then take it out, and his hand had turned white. Well, you know, that's something that Charlton Heston couldn't really do, you know. So I suppose it does look a bit paler, you know. So it tells you that Moses actually looked very different to Charlton Heston. So there's a lot more biblical references that tell you that the Israelites were actually black people. But yeah, you can like go through it in the Bible. And throughout the what's called the Renaissance period, all of the artwork was replaced throughout Europe. But because Russia, well, it was a kind of insular society at that time, Renaissance didn't get to Russia. So you can go online and search for Russian icons, and you'll find that everybody who was portrayed in the Bible were portrayed black. And after Renaissance, all that artwork was destroyed and replaced with Whitenized versions. But you know, 500 years ago, prior to 500 years ago, this is how they were always depicted. And the last thing is that this man is the ex-president of Egypt, and he was quoted on television to say, "We can't accept the Jews because they left here black but came back white." So, and he literally said that on television. And yeah, he was murdered not long after that.
Nubians.
Say that again?
Nubians.
What about it?
They were to do with the black pharaohs.
Right, again.
They were discriminated against by the ethnic society of 1932, and all their artwork was eradicated.
That happened too, but the Nubians were also indeed, but the Nubians were also part of the ones that I described.
Race, 10-foot-tall people,
I'm coming to that. The last point I'm going to make on this is that Africans and Negroes are two different peoples. You know, race and skin colour are really a red herring. Okay, it's a kind of divisive lie that has been put about, and I'm going to go into this a bit more in detail. But you know, to separate people by perceived race is a distraction. Okay, so we all think that all black people are the same, basically, but they're not. Africans and Negroes are different. They have a different skeletal structure, different skull shape, and and one interesting thing is African people, real Africans, cannot grow hair like Negroes can. So African men cannot grow beards. All right? African women cannot grow afros. All right? It's a very powerful thing. If you see real African women, you'll see that they've always got very, very short hair. Because literally they can't grow it. Rh negative blood. Now this is a bit of a smoking gun, really, because Rh negative blood is blood with a lack of a certain protein on the red blood cells. Okay, Only 15% of the human population are lacking in this protein. But interestingly, it's only 15% of the human population. All other animals have this protein coating on their blood, and it's incompatible with the rest of humanity. When a Rh negative woman conceives of an Rh positive man, the woman's antibodies will attack the baby as a foreign object. Yeah? The baby will have difficulty surviving unless they're given a shot which suppresses the mother's immune system. Yeah? So it's telling you right there that this blood type, which is, has everybody heard of Rh negative blood?
Yeah, well,
audience
part. That's not entirely true. I know an Rh negative and positive couple, they didn't have that problem.
Right. Well, what usually happens these days is that the first baby, right, makes it through. But then the mother's immune system becomes sensitized to it, and then the second one. Sorry? Well, you know what, you can't, with people, you can't say everybody is like this. You'll get exceptions along the way, but generally this is what happens. You get, a long time ago, it was the first baby will be attacked, yeah? But then as people got used to it, it's more like the second baby. And now, and maybe some people never have it, but generally, you can only speak in general terms when you're talking about humans, yeah. Where was I? Oh yeah. Well, scientists don't know where this mutation came from. They've got no idea where it came from. It doesn't, you know, there's no way it can appear naturally, because as I say, it doesn't appear naturally in any species on this earth. And as I said, it's incompatible with the rest of the human species. It's also got a high copper content, which gives it a slightly blue tinge, which is where the term blue bloods came from, because the royal families are Rh negative. We found that out when Prince Charles gave blood back in the 80s, he was Rh negative. So yeah, that's where the term came from, because in the past, it was the royalty who had the Rh negative blood types. They derive their divine right to rule because of they have the blood of the gods. They don't tell you which gods, though. Cunning and wickedness. As I said, this is about a bloodline. Yeah, color, skin color, and race are a distraction. This is about a bloodline, and it's only one bloodline that controls all the corporations in this world. Yeah, it's only one bloodline that controls the banks. It's only one bloodline that's responsible for all the misery that's perpetrated on this earth. It's a wicked bloodline, yeah, and it hates humans. It hates all of us. Okay. When you look back into the fossil record, you find there are these creatures that look vaguely human, but they have these massive skulls. And I'd suggest that these ones were the only ones that survived, but earlier ones would have had a much longer head, just like the alien. So Noah was the only, Noah's family were the only ones who weren't corrupted by this. But it says in the book of Jasher that a week before the flood, Noah had to go out and find wives for his three sons. But the only wives that were available were corrupted ones. So this DNA survived the flood through the offspring of the union of the Noah's children and these corrupted wives. So these are the three sons of Noah, Ham, Shem and Japheth. So the serpent seed survives. Amongst Ham's children were the Canaanites, the Raphaites, the Amalekites, and all the Ites in the Bible, who are described as giants, as six-fingered giants. Okay, so Ham's line was corrupted. in Japheth's line, there was at least one giant. He was called Gog. And but in Shem's line, there were no giants. There were no genetic deformations or genetic anomalies. So his line was the blessed line. His line was the human line. That's what the Bible is telling us. And that is until Esau was born. Okay, the story is that the children of Isaac, who were twins, Jacob and Esau. Esau was the firstborn, and he came out red and hairy, and he became a hunter, and he was wicked and very cunning. So he was expressing the fallen angel DNA. Jacob was not even described because he came out like everybody else. But because Jacob was the human one with the most human DNA, he was given the blessing, even though he was the second born, which goes against tradition. Yes, but that's the story. I can go into lots more detail about it, but you know, I've got lots to go through, so I'm not going to go into the sort of the minutia. But yes, he tricked his father into it.
He displayed
cunning. No, his mother did. His mother did. Yes, his mother did. Right, so but I'm not going to go into detail, but you can go in and read it yourself. And I know, okay, yeah. So Esau became known as Edom, which means red, you know, and after he gave up his birthright, I said he was wicked and cunning and warlike, and he went on to take wives of all the other nations. Eventually, his children basically mixed with all the other nations. And again, his offspring were generally very tall, white-skinned, red-haired, and, you know, red-haired giants, basically. So the Israelites, there were 12 sons of Israel. And I'm not going to go too much into this, but the sons of Jacob became the Israelites. So the Israelites actually were in a blood covenant with the Creator, and were given these commandments to follow. But in Deuteronomy 28, they were told that if they were to keep the commandments, they would be blessed and have all sorts of good things happen to them. But if they weren't to keep the commandments, they were going to be punished. And one of the main punishment was that they were going to go into slavery and affliction. So that started, essentially, with the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD by the Romans. And I don't like quoting the New Testament because I don't believe very much about it. But it says in the New Testament, when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then flee into the mountains. And the only mountains that were available to them were the mountains of Africa. And that's where they went. Now, this is a map of Africa from the 1700s. And you can see what it's called down here. Negro land, okay? Because what happened was the Israelites would escaped into Africa, the African continent, but the Africans didn't want them there amongst themselves, because I guess they still remembered the plagues and the Exodus. So the Israelites basically went across the top of the Sahara, which you'll notice is called the Kingdom of Sarah, okay, which is the second son of Judah, by the way. So they went across the Sahara Desert and down into the wilderness, which is where nobody was living, of West and South Africa. So here's a bit more detail here. So this bit here is called the Grain Coast. It's where the Europeans came in to get their grain. Here's the Tooth Coast. It's where they came in to get their ivory. There's the Gold Coast. No explanation there. And here is the slave coast, and where it says there, Kingdom of Judah. So they're the sons of Judah actually ended up there. Here next to it is what's called Benin. I can't see it, but the Kingdom of Benin is here. Now, the people who lived in Jerusalem, that side of the part of Jerusalem that got attacked by the Romans, were the tribe of Judah and the tribe of Benjamin, or Benjamin. So here you have the Judeans and the Benjamites. In Psalms it tells you that that all the nations were going to come against these people, and they were going to make sure that their name would be forgotten, and they would forget who they are. And that's what's happened. And all these nations are confederate against them. These are all the nations that Esau mixed with. Because Esau felt cheated of his birthright, yeah, the ancestral hatred has remained, yeah, even though he's been spread out across all these different nations. So when the Europeans came to get slaves, not a single African went into slavery. What happened was the slavers came for the Judeans, the Negroes, and it was the Africans who actually sold them into slavery. It was the Arabs and the Africans who sold them into slavery. Right? They didn't sell themselves into slavery. It was the Africans were selling the outsiders, the ones who came in and were actually prospering in the wilderness of their land. So that dispels that myth that Africans were selling each other into slavery. Again, it's not about skin colour, it's about nation, it's about bloodline. So this is commonly seen as the African slave trade, but there was more, much more to this story. Because the Aboriginal Americans were the same people. They were already there in America, and they were black people. They were not the pale-skinned Indians that you're kind of used to. These guys were all, and that looks like my mum actually. that one right there. These were the same people that were over in Africa and also in Europe. I'll get to that in a minute. But what happened was we had black people as the Aboriginal Americans, but there were also some Chinese Mongols who went across the Bering Strait and were inhabiting the northwest of America. And it was those people who actually were given all the reservations. All these people were reclassified as black people, as Negroes, as slaves. Here's the evidence. This is called the Back Creek Stone. And it sat in a museum. It was taken from a Cherokee reservation. It was part of a huge war on the Cherokee reservation, dated 4,000 years old. And it sat there as a bit of a curiosity because nobody could translate it. And until a Hebrew scholar came up and looked at it and realized it was being displayed upside down. And it was actually Hebrew. And it says something like, for the Judeans. And as I said, it's part of a larger wall, but it's the only bit that survived. So they were actually writing in Hebrew 4,000 years ago. So yeah, this is what happened. The Aboriginal Americans were reclassified as black, Negro, and slaves. And the Native Americans were the Chinese Mongols, who mixed also with white people who came over, because there was a thing called the Dawes Rolls, which meant they were classifying who was who, and anybody could come along, any white European could come along and say and pay $5 to be included as an Indian, which meant they get certain rights, they get a piece of land that's not taxable and stuff like that. So there's a saying called the $5 Indian, Yeah, so you could pay $5 and you could be classified as Indian and you'd get all the rights and benefits of being a Native American. But these were not the original Native American or Aboriginal Americans. They also, slaves also came from Europe. And this is the evidence of it. Obviously, evidence of this kind is kind of scant. You can't find very much around. But every now and again, you find some bit of writing that gives you clues. This is from Benjamin Franklin, 1751. And he says, why should Pennsylvania, founded by the English, become a colony of aliens who will shortly be so numerous as to Germanize us instead of us Anglifying them, and will never adopt our language or customs any more than they can acquire our complexion? Okay, saying that they weren't black people. Says, which leads me to add one remark, the number of purely white people in the world is proportionably very small. All of Africa is black or tawny, brown. Asia, chiefly tawny. America, exclusive of the newcomers, wholly so. And in Europe, the Spaniards, Italians, French, Russians, and Swedes are generally of what we call a swarthy complexion. Swarthy means black. As are the Germans also. Okay, so he underlines the point, why increase the sons of Africa by planting them in America? So literally, the Germans and most Europeans at that time, 1751, were black people. Yeah, history has been rewritten. So, how much time have I got? I'm just... Another five. Okay, so I'll just go on about... sorry to jump around a bit, but this is all relevant. It will be pulled together in a little while. So we're going to ask, who were the ancient Greeks? Because we've seen lots of statues and depictions of pale-skinned Greeks and stuff. But if you go back further and you look at some older artifacts, you'll find that they're all black. So who were they? Well, there were three levels of Greek culture. Now, the first one was, if you look in the Bible, it tells you that a person called Jevan was given the area of Greece. But since there was no J in Hebrew, or E, or St. Jevan, yeah, so it would have been pronounced Ioan, okay? So those people were known as the Ionians. Later there were some Israelites, Danites, and Judites who left the Egypt before the Exodus. They became known as the Dorians. And then finally, the white-skinned Macedonians took over the area, and they were known as the Corinthians. And if anybody knows about Greek architecture, there were three styles of architecture: Ionic, Doric, and Corinthian. Okay. Now, what's interesting is that from Mount Seir, where Esau basically ended up living, it's modern-day Petra, you can see Corinthian-style columns on their architecture. And you can actually follow their progress around the world. In Greece, the Corinthian. In Rome, the same. Germany, this country, and America. And this is their path across the world over the centuries. And this is the path of that particular bloodline. So, on a similar note, who were the Spartans? In one of the books that were left out of the Bible, the Maccabees, it tells you that the Spartans were brethren of the Jews there, the Judites there. There's a letter to the Lacedaemonians, as they were called, saying, look, we're brothers, let's make a pact, let's join together. So it tells you right there that the Spartans were actually black people as well. So that film should have had Denzel Washington playing the guy. So, yeah. So, and who were the Trojans? Well, this is quite amazing for me because I just happened to be reading the Iliad at one point, and I was researching this, and as I was looking at the genealogy chart in the 1611 Bible, the names started to match up with what I was reading in the Iliad. So one of the sons or great-great-grandsons of Judah was a guy called Dada. And again, it's in the Iliad that Dada or Dardanus was the father of Erichthonius, who was the father of King Tros, who founded Troy. So again, the Israelites were the Trojans. So the Trojans were black too. And I think I've run out of time there for now, so I'm going to leave it there. Just a quick word about the Anglo-Saxons. The word Saxon actually means sons of Isaac. Okay. The Anglo-Saxons means the angelic sons of Isaac. The angelic sons, and there's been some confusion about this, the angelic sons are the ones that exhibited the fallen angel seed. So the original Saxons were dark-skinned, and the Anglo-Saxons were lighter-skinned. And I didn't actually mention this when I was talking about Greece, but this is the modus operandi of this bloodline. Okay, what they would do is, when there was a population they wanted to conquer, they would infiltrate this population. They would sort of arrive in few numbers, and then some more and a few more, until they had enough power, and they would take over that population, become those people, and rewrite history so you don't know about those people. Okay? And the same thing happened in Germany, Saxony. There was the original Saxons, and then this bloodline came in, took over, and they became the Anglo-Saxons.
According to my etymological research, the word Saxon, it derives from the fact that they carried a blade called a Saxon.
Right, well...
Were they to be called... If Isaac's son was a derivation of that, surely it would be Yitzhak Ben would be the correct Hebrew term.
Well, we're not talking about Hebrews, we're talking about when they came away from Hebrew.
So that's the origin of the word Saxon?
Sorry? I'm disputing what you were saying about why it should have been called. Yeah, when you move away from the original language, the language changes. Okay, right? We're talking about it from the point of view of anglicising things. Yeah. So we anglicise just like we anglicise Brito to Brutus. Yeah. We might have different sources, but you know, my research says they're sons of Isaac and angelic sons of Isaac. Okay, so I was looking at this book from, I can't remember how old it is, The Origins of the Anglo-Saxon Race. Surnames are a very recent thing, okay? People weren't given surnames as a rule. They were just sort of extra identifiers, because there might be two or three Daves in a place. So, you know, if I was good at making roofs, I'd be called Dave Thatcher. You know, or if somebody was good at shoeing horses, Dave Smith. You know, but another identifier was what a person looked like. You know, there's also where a person lived. You know, Dave York or Dave Atwood. You know, Dave who lives at the woods, or as I said, or their physical exploits, like Dave Armstrong. Okay, so you get names like Brun, Brown, Black, Blackman, Blake, and all the derivations of that. I won't go into the Wendish people. So one of the chapters in this book about the origin of the Anglo-Saxon race is a chapter called Our Darker Forefathers, and it says here, you know, there is a higher percentage of people of a mixed brown type living in Hertfordshire, Buckinghamshire, Wiltshire, Dorset, than most other counties, except those in Cornwall or on the old Celtic borders. The inhabitants of these counties are the darkest. Okay, the counties of Hereford and Buckinghamshire have people as dark as Wales. Yeah. the wealth for a dark people. I didn't show you on the on that map that showed the progress of the Iba. There was another migration for the people of who descended from the King Omri in the Bible. Okay, they called themselves the Cimri or the Cimmerians. Okay, they went across the northern part of Europe and ended up in Denmark, Jutland. And they were chased out of that area, Caucasians. And they went... Sorry?
Caucasians.
Sorry?
They went through the Caucasus. And
they went through the Crimea and, yeah. But I don't have the map there, I can't show you, but they ended up in Jutland and they got chased out. They ended up in England and got pushed to the far west. And the Cymru became the Cymru. So they were the Welsh. So it kind of brings us to King James the sixth and the first. He was a black man, okay. Now you can go to the National Portrait Gallery and you'll see a white guy stands looking back at you, but those portraits were basically repainted, okay. What couldn't be painted over were engravings. And in the 1611 Bible, there's an engraving of a black man. He was actually, again, an Israelite of the royal house of Judah, descended from the Pharaoh's line, okay? But what came in through France. Sorry? Yeah, got that, told you. so he was the one who had the Bible translated as faithfully as possible at the time, because... it says in the foreword, actually, that there were people, and he meant the Roman Catholic Church, who wanted to destroy the word of the Most High. And he didn't want that to happen. So that's why he had the Bible translated. He sat on the thrones of England, Scotland, Ireland, and France, actually. And he unified them into one kingdom. And I said, there's the bogus painting of James. He's been smeared with allegations of homosexuality and sleeping with his mother, but they're all baseless claims. Because how can you be homosexual and have 9 children with your wife? You have to have an awful lot of sex to get 9 children, I think. So yeah, more pictures, engravings of him. And there's an engraving of James and his wife, Anne of Denmark, with a afro. Yeah.
Truth from a fake Jewish Israeli man, you know, some people from all races, nationalities, just want the truth in life. They just want the truth in life. They too have been deceived, made to believe they are someone or something they're not. And when they recognize the truth, they spill it or bring it out.
The true Jews, according to the Bible, you can check it in the Bible, you can read Job 30:30 and some other places. They have never been white. They have been people of color. And they have not stopped in Ethiopia. They were in Ethiopia, Sudan, and they have settled in West Africa. From West Africa, they have been taken as slaves to America. Brothers and sisters, blacks of America, it's you. You are the true Hebrews. You are the true Hebrews from the Bible. America gonna do everything, gonna invest as much money as it has, gonna fight as much wars as they can, gonna invite as much weapons as they can just to hide this away from you. Gonna take Israel, gonna bring white people here and to tell you these are the Jews. Gonna kill you, gonna kill Arabs, gonna mistreat white people like this guy, just to tell you this lie, that you are nobody and we are the Jews with all the history and so on. It has been deleted, your history. You don't know who you are. Don't forget about it. This is why America has been taking your history away, never to find out that it's all about you. I'm telling you this, please, I don't ask you to come to Israel and to start a revolution. I'm just asking you to start thinking this way, to believe me a little bit, because I'm living in Israel and I'm part of this injustice. I really believe that people like me and you, we can bring the justice back. Thank you.
The one thing in the Bible that identifies who we are as a people is Deuteronomy chapter 28. It also shows you who the fake Jewish people in the land of Israel today is not. They are not the true Israelites, because the curses and blessings of Deuteronomy chapter 28 do not fit them, but they fit us like a shoe.
Black history. According to the public school system, Negroes were brought to America in 1619, forced to work as slaves on plantations, until one day this great white man named Abraham Lincoln came along and felt bad for the slaves and signed the Emancipation Proclamation in 1863, which freed the slaves. But there were still some bad whiteys in the southern states that passed Jim Crow laws for segregation. Afterwards, there came more whites that felt bad and then gave blacks civil rights in the 1960s, then allowed a black man to have the presidential office named Barack Obama. Now blacks are finally equal to whites. We can all get along. The end. Now, moving right along to our English lecture for the day. I don't think so. Black history. What do you know about black history? Let me ask you a question. Prior to the transatlantic slave trade in the 1600s, what was your nationality? What did you call yourself? Some may say African. Well, Africa is a continent, and in that continent, there's over 47 different countries in there. Which one do you come from? What language did you speak prior to the 1600s? Was it English? There's over 1,500 dialects being spoken in the land of Africa. Pick one. What clothing did you wear? Was it high heels and stilettos? Skinny jeans and Vans? What food did you eat? Hamburgers and hot dogs? French fries and SpaghettiOs? What religion did you partake in? Who was your God? Was it Christianity and Cesare Borgia? Most of you have no idea about the answer to these questions. You have no recollection of any history prior to the transatlantic slave trade. Now, is that a coincidence or by random chance? I don't think so. Have you ever asked yourself, why is it that in the public school system that every time the subject of black history is taught, it always begins in the 1600s and with slavery? Why is that? Doesn't that raise some antennas and spark inquiry? Why is it that the public school system is so committed to revolving black history solely on the past 400 years? Why is that? Is it because there's a deficiency in historical data? Or maybe it's because there's no history at all prior to the 1600s? Maybe black people just poofed out of thin air, sporadically, landed on slave ships, and they said, hey, we got a new species here, and start importing and exporting them all over the world. Maybe that's what happened. The question arises, what is the drawback on this history? Why does it keep being withheld? What's the big idea about it? Why is it being held hostage? That's the question. Why can't it be expounded on? 100 years prior to the 1600s? 300 years? 500 years? 1,000 years? Why is that information not being revealed? What's the big secret? What's the mysticism about it? What you're going to come to realize is that your identity is the biggest kept secret on the planet Earth. Oh, you thought that NASA and the space station and the secret missions being conducted by them, oh, you thought that was the biggest kept secret on Earth. No, this is bigger than that. You thought that the government and the CIA and the FBI hiding information about UFOs and Planet X and Nibiru and aliens, you thought that was the biggest information and biggest kept secret. No, this is bigger than that. The elite Confederate has spent billions of dollars and constructed an innumerable amount of psychological stratagem to ensure that you never received and acquired this information that's about to be put out. You're about to receive pertinent information from some of the most reputable biblical scholars, historians, and archaeologists. And they all know something that you don't know. And that's your identity. Ham, the youngest son of Noah, born probably about 96 years before the flood, and one of eight persons to live through the flood, he became the progenitor of the dark races. Not the Negroes, but the Egyptians, Ethiopians, Libyans, and Canaanites. Wait. The churches and the pastors, which are set up by the government, all teach in unison a doctrine that all black people come from the seed of Ham. But once you open up scholastic sources, you'll find out that the biblical scholars say something totally different from what's taught in Orthodox Christianity. What do they mean by Ham is the father of the dark races, but not the Negroes? The Negroes themselves are a dark race of people. So how can you say that Ham is the father of all these dark races and exclude the Negroes? What are the biblical scholars trying to convey? What the biblical scholars are saying is that you're not African. There's only four families, according to the Bible, that make up the native population of Africa, or the land of Ham. And the biblical scholars know that you don't descend from any one of those four families. In order to write that in a scholastic and academic book, the biblical scholars have done extensive and thorough research on both the so-called Negroes and the Africans, the native Africans. And they've came to the conclusion after the extensive research that the Negroes don't have anything to do with the native Africans at all. They're two totally separate people. In the 1840s, Morton collaborated with George R. Glidden, an Egyptologist, who provided him with mummy heads and information about the racial significance of Egyptian tomb inscriptions in Crania Egyptiaca, published in 1844. Morton pointed out that both cranial and archaeological evidence showed that the Egyptians were not Negroes. In 1840, Dr. Morton was trying to find out the racial origin of the so-called Negroes that were in America in slavery. So he got together with the Egyptologists, which supplied him with the mummy heads, and what he did was conduct an extensive research on the cranial remains of the heads in Egypt, in contrast to the cranial remains of the heads in America. And what he found out is that the Negroes that were in slavery were not Africans. He found out that the skulls were two totally different types of skulls. The Negro's head was longer than the Egyptian head. The physical characteristics from the outside look similar, with the thick lips and the broad nose. But once you start delving into the real characteristics, they found out that they were two totally different people, as abolitionists and colonizationists had maintained, and that in fact, blacks had been relegated to the same servile position in ancient Egypt as in modern America. But what Dr. Morton did discover is that the Negroes that were serving slavery in America served the same position and servitude in ancient Egypt when they matched other skulls and other cranial remains in Egypt. They said these are exact matches. So what are the scholars saying? What you're going to find out is that they're saying that you are the biblical Israelites. Yes, you're the same exact people that served slavery in the land of Egypt. You're the same exact people that God sent Moses to go redeem under the hand of Pharaoh. You're the same exact people. And when you read the Bible, you'll find out that slavery is a central theme in the Bible. It's a reoccurring theme with the Israelites. The Israelites cannot run away and get away from serving slavery. It continues to happen over and over, all the way up until today. You came out of Egypt as slaves, came down into the land of Israel. No sooner as you got there, then you had the Assyrians come, capture the land of Israel, and take you and make you slaves. In the ninth year of Hoshea, the king of Assyria took Samaria and carried Israel away into Assyria. You came out of the land of Assyria, went back to the land of Israel. Then the Babylonians came, which are the modern day Ethiopians, the Cushites, came to the land of Israel and made you slaves. So all Israel were reckoned by genealogies. And behold, they were written in the book of the kings of Israel and Judah, who were carried away to Babylon for their transgression. You came out of the Babylonian captivity, went back to the land of Israel. Then the Persians came on down there, took the Israelites, and made you slaves. For we were bondmen, yet our God hath not forsaken us in our bondage, but hath extended mercy unto us in the sight of the kings of Persia. You came back from the Persian Medo captivity, went back to the land of Israel, rebuilt the temple up. Then the Greeks came on down there, took you and made you slaves, to entreat them that they would take the yoke from them. For they saw that the kingdom of the Grecians did oppress Israel with servitude. After you came from the Greek captivity, you went back into the land of Israel, rebuilt the temple because the Greeks were sacrificing swine and pig on the altars. No sooner as you came back to the land of Israel, then the Romans came and had you during the time of Christ as slaves. It was so much slavery going on with the Israelites that Jeremiah himself had to ask, is Israel just put on earth just to be slaves? Is that your whole purpose? Just to be servitude to other nations? Is Israel a servant? Is he a homeborn slave? Why is he spoiled? So you might be asking yourself, if the so-called Negro is part of the 12 tribes of Israel, how in the world did you get to the west coast of Africa? And when ye shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. This is Christ right here speaking to the Israelites. He says, when you see Jerusalem compassed or surrounded by the Roman armies, then know that the desolation or the destruction of the land of Israel is getting ready to happen. The Romans getting ready to come in here and tear some stuff up. Then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let them which are in the midst of it depart out. And Christ says, when you see the Romans coming in, you better get ready to flee into the mountains. And what you're going to realize is that the mountains that he was talking about was the land of Africa. It was the same exact place that Mary and Joseph took Jesus when they were fleeing from Herod, when he was trying to come find Jesus to kill him. They went right into Africa, and the Israelites went into Africa as well, fleeing from the Romans. In the year 65 BC, the Roman armies under General Pompey captured Jerusalem. In 70 AD, General Vespasian and his son Titus put an end to the Jewish state with great slaughter. During the period from Pompey to Julius, it has been estimated that over 1 million Jews fled into Africa, fleeing from Roman persecution and slavery. The slave markets were full of black Jewish slaves. Over 1 million of you Israelites fled from the land of Israel into the land of Africa, running away from the Romans, because the Romans was coming to put slaughter to the Israelites. The ones that didn't take heed to the prophecy of Christ when he said, you better leave and go to the mountains, go to Africa. When they got caught by the Romans, they were taken back to Europe and sold in slavery and put in servitude and became gladiators, put in the lions' dens. The pagans and the Romans attacked the Jews indiscriminately. Both the Jewish soldiers and the uninvolved peaceful population without mercy. As a result of this merciless attack, many Jews fled to those parts of Northwest Africa known as Tunisia, Algeria, Morocco, and Mauritania. Many other Jews fled to other areas where Rome did not have any jurisdiction. This was to the region of the south, the Sahara Desert, and the Sudan. Grazel says, such is the explanation of how the Sahara Desert first acquired Jewish tribes, toughened by a fighting tradition and possessed of physical characteristics, black, which, it is said, still makes them approximate very closely the original Jewish population of Palestine. And after migrating from Israel and dwelling on the northwestern parts of Africa, after you were fighting vigorously with the Romans, you had no choice but to start migrating to the southern regions of Africa where the Romans didn't have any jurisdiction. Because the Romans were relentless and they were adamant about putting all Israelites to death. So in order to get any type of peace, the Israelites had to start migrating to the sub-Sahara parts of Africa. The scholars know this for a fact. The biblical scholars know this for a fact. They know all the history of the Israelites and their migration patterns. Whatever may be thought of the more or less mythological traditions connected with the earliest Jews in North Africa, it is now practically an established fact that a Jewish nation, Jewish at least in faith, and perhaps too in origin, long held sway south of the Sahara. In later centuries, Jews are believed to have settled in Western Africa during the height of the Songhai, Mali, Ghana, and Kanem-Bornu empires. According to accounts from explorers of the region, several powerful Jewish families of the Songhai Empire were of Jewish origin. Some accounts place West African Jewish communities in the Andu forest of Dahomey, south of Timbuktu. In the 1930s, these groups still maintained a Torah scroll written in Aramaic that had been burned into parchment with a hot iron instead of ink so it could not be changed. In the 1930s, the historians went over there and still found Israelites over there that didn't get captured in the slave trade, still practicing the Hebraic faith, still knowing who they were. With a Torah, which is the first five books of Moses, written in Aramaic. That's the ancient language. And it's a shame that they have to burn it in hot iron so the European colonialists don't come over there tampering with it and taking the evidence and trying to hide the history. It's a shame that they have to do that. It is a total shame that they have to do that. The black Jews had an advantage over the African tribes. They carried their culture, history, laws, and written records with them. The Jews made use of every opportunity. They were an industrious and skillful people. In the Jewish Ghanaian states were found kings, princes, governors, generals, secretaries, treasurers, revenue agents, judges, architects, engineers, doctors, historians, language interpreters, mathematicians, jewelers, sculptors, masons, carpenters, painters of art, goldsmiths, leather workers, potters, armorers, saddlers, blacksmith, agriculturalist, etc. Who told you that you was a bunch of Negroes running around on the west coast of Africa, butt naked, swinging from vines? Who told you that lie? You were and still are a prestigious people, a skillful people. The decline of Jewish communities of the West African Maghreb most likely began with the influx of Arab invaders into North Africa starting in 640 CE and later into West Africa in the 1300s and 14 CE. So after you had established communities and empires on the west coast of Africa, after the 7th century, that's when Muhammad and his band of thugs came down there to the west coast with the Quran in one hand and a sword in another one. And they were forcibly converting the Israelites into that nonsense Islam. Yeah, I said it, nonsense Islam, because that's not what we were dealing with. That's the Arabs' religion. That's not what we were dealing with. And that was the decline of the Hebraic community over there in the west coast of Africa. And that was the forefront in the beginning of the slave trade. Yay. And what have ye to do with me, O Tyre and Zidon, and all the coast of Palestine? Tyre, Zidon, and the coast of Palestine, those are all ancient Africans that God is referring to. Will ye render me a recompense? And if ye recompense me, swiftly and speedily will I return your recompense upon your own head. Because ye have taken my silver and my gold, and carried into your temples my goodly pleasant things. The children also of Judah and the children of Jerusalem have ye sold unto the Grecians. The Africans got together with the so-called Grecians or the Europeans, and they commenced in selling the Israelites that were dwelling on the west coast of Africa in slavery. There's your slave trade right there in the Bible. Both buyers, Europeans, and sellers, Africans, saw the people traded into captivity on the African coast as outsiders. Now, why did those Africans see you as outsiders? Because you were some people that migrated and encroached on their land. They knew you were not the same exact people. The customs that you had, the way you moved, they knew you were not the same people, so they had no problem commencing in a slave trade with the Europeans. Do you be crazy to believe that Africans were selling their own people? That makes no sense at all. When the Europeans put that in the textbooks, they're using technicalities, saying Africans sold other Africans. When they're using technicalities. What they mean to say is native Africans were selling Israelites that were living in Africa. It'd be no different if somebody wrote history of 500 years from now and say there was a slave trade that happened here in America. Say black people got together and start selling white people to the Chinese. If somebody with the same mindset that the Europeans have wrote history 500 years from now, they would say Americans were selling other Americans to the Chinese. When it's two totally different nation of people living in America. You can't just say Americans sold other Americans. Two totally different people. It's the same exact scenario on the west coast of Africa. There are both oral and written explanations that trace the origin of the Igbo. And the most tantalizing is an association of the Igbo to the Hebrew race. This assumption is based on the fact that Igbo culture has many similar traditional customs like that of the Jews. Similar customs are observed in marriage negotiations, childbirth and circumcision, restitution, attitude to totem animals and taboos, as well as hospitality to others, especially to strangers, etc. The Igbo are therefore said to be the split and lost group or tribe of Israel that refused to wander further northeast with Moses, but preferred going down southward. The Igbo people have many Jewish traditions. Naomi Katz, the current Israeli ambassador in Nigeria, and others point to their possible ancient Israelite origins. See, the scholars, they've done their research on the Igbo tribe, extensive research. and they've compared the traditions of the Igbo tribe and they've matched them up to the biblical traditions of the Israelites. And they said, whoa, these are strikingly similar. The only way that these people could be practicing the Hebraic faith this close is if they were the biblical Israelites themselves. So you may ask yourself, what is the significance of the Igbo tribe to the so-called Negro in the Americas? When you do the research, what you're gonna find out is that the Igbo tribe is one of the main sought out tribes that were captured and sold in the transatlantic slave trade and came right here to America. The British were the major buyers before they banned their own slave traffic in 1807. They were replaced by the Portuguese and the Spanish for as long as the traffic continued here. The majority of the captives were speakers of Igbo dialect. These people knew exactly who they were buying and selling, both the Africans and the Europeans. The Europeans, which are the Romans went after 70 AD, they went conquering and they done hid themselves under different nationalities after they done conquered the native people that were in those lands in Europe. Hid themselves under the French, under the British, under the Portuguese. They're the same exact Romans. And all they're doing is continuing the agenda that was put in place in 70 AD. When they came down there looking for the Israelites, it's the same exact agenda. And carrying it forward to today, it's the same exact agenda. They knew exactly who they were aiming for. It's not by coincidence that all the history matches up perfectly with the Bible prophecies. It's not a coincidence. And then they push a doctrine on you in church talking about it doesn't matter. So then you never go and look for this information. Now you see exactly why they don't put none of this in black history, why they don't go prior to the 1600s. You start digging prior to the 1600s, and then you find out you come or descend from the Igbo tribe. You start doing your research. Well, let me find out a little bit more about this Igbo tribe. Then you find out that the Igbo tribe are known as fact descend from the 12 tribes of Israel. So then you say, hold on. Something's not right here. That's the exact reason why they don't go prior to the 1600s. You're not supposed to find out this information. They're supposed to keep renaming your nationalities every few years to cause confusion and to have you confused, not knowing who you are. Each year, something else come out. First you call Negro, then you call color. Then 10 years later, they switch it to African American. It's all by design. Now you have to be asking yourself, if you are supposed to be the people of God, the chosen people of God, why is it that he continues to allow you to keep going into slavery after slavery after slavery? And why does he have you building up everybody's civilization off of the back of your slave labor? And it shall come to pass, when thou shalt show this people all these words, and they shall say unto thee, wherefore hath the Lord pronounced all this great evil against us? Or what is our iniquity? Or what is our sin that we have committed against the Lord our God? Then thou shalt say unto them, because your fathers have forsaken me, saith the Lord, and have walked after other gods, and have served them, and have worshipped them, and have forsaken me, and have not kept my law. What you're gonna realize is that when Moses brought you out of the land of Egypt and you entered into the wilderness, you entered into a covenant with the Most High God, the creator of everything you see in heaven and in earth. You entered in a blood in and blood out agreement with the creator. And he kept his end of the bargain, but you never kept yours. And he took the book of the covenant and read in the audience of the people. And they said, all that the Lord have said, we will do and be obedient. And Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people and said, behold, the blood of the covenant which the Lord hath made with you concerning all these words. Once Moses sprinkled the blood on you, there was no way out of it. You entered into the covenant. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations on the earth. And all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee if thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. You see, if you kept your end of the bargain, the deal was the Most High was going to set you above all nations on the planet Earth. You know, the same spot that the Europeans have today, that was supposed to be your spot if you kept his laws, statutes, and commandments. But, that means there's a stipulation. There's two sides of the bargain. It shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. Thy sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people, and thine eyes shall look and fail with longing for them all the day long, and there shall be no might in thine hand. Thou shalt beget sons and daughters, but thou shalt not enjoy them, for they shall go into captivity. The stranger that is within thee shall get up above thee very high, and thou shalt come down very low. Moreover, all these curses shall come upon thee and shall pursue thee and overtake thee till thou be destroyed, because thou hearkenest not unto the voice of the Lord thy God to keep his commandments and his statutes which he commanded thee. And they shall be upon thee for a sign and for a wonder, and upon thy seed forever, because thou servest not the Lord thy God with joyfulness and with gladness of heart for the abundance of all things. Therefore shalt thou serve thine enemies, which the Lord shall send against thee, in hunger and in thirst and in nakedness and in want of all things. And he shall put a yoke of iron upon thy neck until he have destroyed thee. God says you'd have the yokes of iron on your neck until he have destroyed you. So that means when he take the yokes of iron off, you were destroyed. When did that happen? In 1863, when Abraham Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation. The yokes of iron came off. But at that time, your whole history had been whipped out of you.
When the master gives you something, you take it. He gave it a name. It's a nice name. It's Toby. And it's going to be yours till the day you die. Now, I know you understand me, and I want to hear it. Again! I want to hear you say your name. Your name is Toby. What's your name?
Gunther.
Lord God, help that boy. They're gonna whip him dead.
What's your name? Say it. Toby. Who are you? Say your name. What's your name?
Toby.
So that the man that is tender among you and very delicate, his eye shall be evil towards his brother and toward the wife of his bosom and toward the remnant of his children, which he shall leave. You wonder why it's black on black crime? You didn't keep your part of the covenant. You wonder why black men always leave the children? You didn't keep your part of the covenant. Also, every sickness and every plague which is not written in the book of this law, them will the Lord bring upon thee until thou be destroyed. Why are you number one in HIV? You didn't keep your part of the covenant. Why are you number one in hypertension and high blood pressure? You didn't keep your part of the covenant. Why are you number one in high cholesterol? You didn't keep your part of the covenant. Why are you number one in diabetes? You didn't keep your part of the covenant. Why are you number one in all negative effects across the board? You didn't keep your part of the covenant. And the Lord shall scatter thee among all people from one end of the earth even unto the other. And there thou shalt serve other gods, which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone. And among these nations shalt thou find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest. But the Lord shall give thee there a trembling heart, and failing of eyes, and sorrow of mind. And thy life shall hang in doubt before thee, and thou shalt fear day and night, and have no assurance of thy life. In the morning thou shalt say, would God it were even, and in the evening thou shalt say, would God it were morning? For the fear of thine heart wherewith thou shalt fear, and for the sight of thine eyes which thou shalt see. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again. The word Egypt in the Bible means bondage or slavery. I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. So when God says he's gonna bring you into Egypt again, he's saying, I'm gonna bring you into slavery again with ships. But this time you're going with ships, packed up like sardines in a can. By the way whereof I spake unto thee, thou shalt see it no more again. And there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen, and no man shall buy you. And God says, no man shall buy you. Back in the biblical days, you would be able to buy or redeem a slave by payment. But God says, no man is going to be able to redeem you out of this slavery. This last one I bring you to, this last Egypt, nobody's going to get you out of it. Marcus Garvey tried to get you out of it, didn't work. Martin Luther King tried to get you out of it, didn't work. Malcolm X tried to get you out of it, didn't work. Louis Farrakhan tried to get you out of it, didn't work. Al Sharpton tried to get you out of it, didn't work. Why? Because you are still breaking the covenant.
Now, for more on your history, black people who think you are a Christian, an African American, who think you can choose to not be an Israelite and go to the lake of fire for your stupid choice, listen to this.
If you're the real Israelites, who are these people over there in the land of Israel claiming to be you? Those are Romans, Europeans. They got pushed up in the South Georgia, Russia, in the Caucasus Mountains, and hid themselves under the name of Khazars. Between the 8th and 9th century, the Khazarian Empire under King Bulan adopted the traditions of the Israelites and mixed it with paganism and called it Judaism. Yes, we know your history too.
We don't think Jews are a part of God. No, Jews are nothing but another part of that same race of devils that come out of Europe. They didn't even come out of the Holy Land. They come out of the caves of Europe. A Jew, a Frenchman, an Irishman, all of them the same thing. A race of devils.
Then after the Holocaust, which was politically motivated, the elite used that as a pretext to invade the land of Israel and took those Khazarian converts and placed them in that land in 1948.
In May of 1948, a new Jewish state, Israel, was born in a bath of blood. Jewish troops routed Arab forces from the city of Haifa in the first of a series of battles that were to reverberate through the years. In the year of independence, fighting was fierce in the Negev desert area. Here, Israeli troops routed the Arabs and took hundreds of prisoners. Meanwhile, on May 14, 1948, the new government, headed by David Ben-Gurion, is installed in Tel Aviv. Thus, for the first time since the Roman Legion destroyed Jerusalem in the year 70 AD, the Jewish people have a nation of their own. United Nations teams accompany Israeli soldiers under the white flag to retrieve the bodies of soldiers killed in the continuing strife with Arab troops. The UN was able to effect some uneasy pacts calling for a truce, but skirmishes continued to break out. Dr. Chaim Weizmann joined Premier Ben-Gurion in the government. The Jewish patriot became president as Israel went before the United Nations to seek a place in that world body. The Middle Eastern Arabic nations were in violent opposition, and when Israel was voted a membership, they walked out in a body. For the rest of the day, their seats remained empty, but they returned the next morning to no further incident. Thus, history was made as the Jewish state of Israel was born. Conceived in strife and weaned on violence, Israel has flourished to become a constructive voice in world affairs. Her flag became a symbol of hope.
To destabilize the Middle East. Prior to that, those people never lived in the land of Israel. Prior to 1948, those people never stepped foot in the land of Israel. Those are Europeans hiding themselves, European Romans hiding themselves under Jewish. That's what they keep doing each time. They keep going different places and taking on different nationalities. They're the same exact people. These are the same exact people that funded your transatlantic slave trade. Yes, the same Jewish man, the same Romans. These are the same people that's responsible for your 400-year short span black history curriculum. These are the same exact people that control the media outlets and push rap music on the whole black community and support it and push it on the forefront. The same exact people. They control all the media. These are the same exact people that are responsible for your Christian churches in all the neighborhoods in the black community. The Bible says when the real Jews get in the land of Israel, there will be no more war. Since those converts, Khazarian converts, went into the land, it's only been war. They don't fit the prophecies. They over there dealing with Satan. I know thy works and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich. And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan, using the Babylonian Talmud as their authoritative source. These people are not the real Jews, and they have nothing to do with the Most High God and the biblical Israelites. They're not the real Jews, and they're dealing with Satan.
Let's see what the former president of Iran, Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, from 2005 to 2013 has to say about the fake Jews in Israel. He almost let the cat out of the bag, but he remembered the Talmud that the nations have against us, the true Israelites. Psalms 83, verse 2 through 8. But you should know that those Israelis are lying. They are not Jews, but a bunch of corrupt criminals who abuse the name of Judaism. But you should know that those Israelis are lying. They are not Jews, but a bunch of corrupt criminals who abused the name of Judaism.
Don't want this prophecy to go forth. They're going to do anything in their power to offset the prophecies and prolong their rulership. Because they know that once the Israelites are in rulership or in authority, that all these nations that had a hand in enslaving the Israelites, they're all going in captivity. It's going to be their turn for servitude. For the Lord will have mercy on Jacob and will yet choose Israel and set them in their own land. And the stranger shall be joined with them, and they shall cleave to the house of Jacob, and the people shall take them and bring them to their place, and the house of Israel shall possess them in the land of the Lord for servants and handmaids, and they shall take them captives whose captives they were, and they shall rule over their oppressors. Therefore, all they that devour thee shall be devoured, and all thine adversaries, every one of them, shall go into captivity, and they that spoil thee shall be a spoil, and all that prey upon thee will I give for a prey. He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints. The elite have got together with their top scholars in their think tanks, and they know these prophecies to a T. They didn't study this book back and forth. They understand all the breakdowns and prophecies. So in order to prevent these things, they have to suppress history and rewrite history and flood the media outlets with all types of futile material like rap music, Atlanta Housewives, and other reality TV nonsense to keep your mind occupied on entertainment and divert it from anything with any significance. And the success rate of that to black people is extremely high. The black man won't pick up a book if his life depended on it. A book is kryptonite to the black man. It's like spraying Raid on a roach. They say if you want to hide anything from a black man, you put it in a book. But despite these efforts of trying to offset prophecy, there's Israelites waking up all over the world by the thousands, coming up out of sleep and getting rid of these Gentile gods and coming back to the Most High God, the creator of heaven and earth, and keeping their end of the bargain. For the children of Israel shall abide many days without a king and without a prince and without a sacrifice and without an image and without an ephod and without a teraphim. Afterward shall the children of Israel return and seek the Lord their God and David their king, and shall fear the Lord and his goodness in the latter days. The kingdom of heaven rulership, the governing body, is being set up right now in the midst of everyone, and nobody even knows it. While America is on an economic decline, God is raising up the ruling government of the kingdom of heaven. He says, even though the children of Israel are as the sand of the sea, only a small remnant are going to be saved from his wrath. Esaias also crieth concerning Israel, though the number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, a remnant shall be saved. Because the majority of you Israelites going to be too caught up and bugged out of your mind and caught up in the world and caught up in Christianity to even give the Creator a thought and even to consider to go back and keep your part of the covenant. But God says he's not sending you in slavery no more. He says if you didn't learn this time from all the captivities you've been under, if you didn't learn from getting your backs whipped, if you didn't learn from being hanged, if you didn't learn from having your sons and daughters sold, he says, I'm not bringing you into captivity no more after America. This is the last captivity. He has another plan for you. You got another punishment coming. It's called the lake of fire. But the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. And you're going to be there for a very long time. But to those that have an ear and come back and return to the Heavenly Father, He's going to make a new covenant with you. For finding fault with them, He saith, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. The Bible says that the new covenant is with the Israelites, not all nations. He made the first covenant with you, and He's making the next covenant with you as well. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days. What does it mean, after those days? It's talking about when you get into the wilderness. Yes, you have to go to the wilderness again. The same way when you came out of Egypt and you went into the wilderness and made the first covenant, is the same exact way when you come out of America, which is the modern Egypt, you're going to have to go into the wilderness again. And I will bring you out from the people and will gather you out of the countries wherein you are scattered, with a mighty hand and with a stretched out arm and with fury poured out. And I will bring you into the wilderness of the people, and there will I plead with you face to face, like as I pleaded with your fathers in the wilderness of the land of Egypt, so will I plead with you, saith the Lord God. And I will cause you to pass under the rod, and I will bring you into the bond of the covenant. The covenant is going to be made after Christ returns. That's the new covenant. Then in the new covenant now, you're still under the same exact covenant you made when you came out of Egypt. That's a binding covenant right now. I will put my laws in their mind and write them in their hearts. And I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. And God says He's going to put His laws in your mind. Yes, those same laws that your Christian church teaches have done away with, those are the laws that are going to govern the kingdom of heaven. The same way America has their laws that govern America, the laws written in the Bible in the first five books of Moses, those are the laws that's going to govern the kingdom of heaven. Those are the same exact laws that you promised and made a pact with the Most High saying that you would keep, and you refuse to keep to this day. That this is a rebellious people, lying children, children that will not hear the law of the Lord, which say unto the seers, see not, and to the prophets, prophesy not unto us right things, speak unto us smooth things, prophesy deceits. Yet the number of the children of Israel shall be as the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured nor numbered. And it shall come to pass that in the place where it was said unto them, ye are not my people, there it shall be said unto them, ye are the sons of the living God. In these same exact places where you were scattered for a reproach and called by different names like African American, Negro, and colored people, and where you were told in church that you were a Gentile, in these same exact places, it's now being told to you that you're actually the children of Israel. Prophecy is being fulfilled right now. It's up to you now to make a choice. Either you're going to come back and keep your end of the bargain, or you're going to still stay out in the world. And if you stay out in the world, the only thing you can look forward to is weeping and gnashing of teeth. The Most High is extending out His hand one last time. It's either you're going to repent and come back, or you're going to die in your sins. You can hang on to whatever you want. You still want to worship the Gentiles' gods? You go for it. The Gentiles can teach that the law is done away with. They wasn't back there in the wilderness, and they wasn't back there with the blood sprinkled on them. They wasn't under a covenant. They weren't back there saying, we will obey. You did. The Most High never gave them no laws to keep, but he gave it to you. He showeth his word unto Jacob, his statutes and his judgments unto Israel. He hath not dealt so with any nation. And as for his judgments, they have not known them. Praise ye the Lord. So there's no punishment for them not keeping the laws. But there is a great punishment for you not keeping it. So it's time to decide. Either you're going to be in or you're out. But now you know who you are.
You are the people about whom the Bible is speaking who will stand up in the last day when the trumpet is sounded. We believe that the 20 million black people in America in the last day will be taught the truth. The trumpet of truth will sound in your ear. And it's being sounded today, the trumpet of truth. And this truth strikes your ear and strikes your heart. It'll open your eyes. It'll open your ears. It'll make you stand up. It'll do the same thing for you that truth did for the dry bones in the valley. Because the picture of dry bones in the valley is talking about you. The picture of Lazarus laying dead 4 days is talking about you. You are Lazarus. You are the dry bones. You are the prodigal son. You are the lost sheep. You are the people about whom the Bible is speaking who will stand up in the last day when the trumpet is sounded. Black people are waking up. Black people are standing up. Black people are rising up, and they're throwing fright into that knee-shaking white man.
We'll be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
TikTok is real.